They don't want to hear what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, I don't blame them.
I don't blame them either.
Okay, if you'll find your seat, we'll get started. I want to welcome you to Maranatha Baptist Fellowship. My name is Jeremy. I'm the pastor here. Thank you for joining us. Of all the churches in Topeka that you could have gone to, you decided to join us here, and we're grateful and we're thankful that you're here. As you walked in, I hope you got a bulletin. It's got a lot of good information that you need to be made aware of. The first thing, there's some Bible studies that are offered. Along with those, Sunday school, if you're not involved in a Bible study and none of those look very interesting to you, I would encourage you to come to Sunday school Sunday mornings at 9 o'clock. We have a number of them that you can join, that you can be a part of. And that's just a good way to get your feet wet, to start to learn more and to grow more. Also, under that, there's a special called business meeting January 29th. We're going to have a question and answer session for Russ Berlew and Barry Hardy. We're going to call them as elders. The leadership body, the elders and deacons and staff have met with them. We've talked to them, and we feel that they need to be elders in our church, and so we're going to give that to the church. Again, that's the last Sunday in January. It'll be immediately following the service. Question and answer session, and then we're going to move right into voting on it. And then also today there's a ministry leaders meeting following the worship service. Again, that's for the five ministry leader heads that will get together and write some stuff down and go about our business. Today is Sanctity of Life Sunday. So, in the back, there are some baby bottles that we are asking you to take home. And as you come across spare change, if you would fill these up with spare change and then return them, and we will get them to the Caring Pregnancy Option here in Topeka, Kansas. There's some more information on Caring Pregnancy Option if you're interested. But this way, it gives us an opportunity to meet their needs as they come up with those needs. There is also a video. Holding the bottle. Show everybody. The last thing that you need to know is in your bulletin is a tear-off. If you're a visitor, if you'd fill that out, put your information on it so we can get a hold of you, touch base with you, talk to you, pray with you. If you're a visitor and or a member and you just have a prayer request that you want us to be praying about, you can also fill that out. There's a box in the back. Everybody can turn around and see the box in the back. If you fold that up and put that in there, that gets it to us, and we can begin to pray with you and for you, and we can make contact with you. So, with that, everyone go ahead and stand up. And this side can welcome that side, and that side can welcome that side. Okay, come on, Lils. Thank you. Set it up there. What?
We always play with it at nighttime.
Good. You've been good at school? Really? Been doing what the teacher says? Okay. Come on, sis. Lily. From Topeka?
I just moved up here in August.
Oh, from where? Okay. Okay.
Highway 160.
Yep. Yep.
Do you know where Metz Lodge is?
I do.
Okay, we're 20 miles closer than that.
Okay.
On the same highway.
Okay, yeah. Well, what brought you to Topeka?
My daughter's both up here.
Okay.
One's been up here 20 years.
He came in a sweater vest and all. How adorable. I know, that's why I'm always. Yes.
You can tell everybody missed last week.
It's good, yeah. Everybody's back. Everybody's back in town. Yeah. Right.
seated. This is the unique part of our service where we basically turn it over to you and let you share praises that have gone on in the last week, except for the fact, we didn't have church last week, and so there may be a few more than normal, but you had some, right? Okay.
Friday morning, Doyle went out to let the dog out, and he came back in. He said, "Vonda, why is there a semi truck in Mom and Dad's driveway?" And I said, "Well, I don't know." So I called my mom. I said, "Mom, why is there a semi truck?" And this is like 6:45 in the morning. "Why is there a semi truck in your driveway?" And she said, "Well, let me tell you. 1:30 this morning, we woke up to headlights and the diesel engine 18-wheeler stuck in our yard." I said, "What happened?" She said, "Their GPS told them we were a truck stop." So, needless to say, my dad and that land out there, the blessing God has given him, and he takes care of it, but we need to be very careful that God's blessings don't become our God. And he was very, very, very upset, to say the least, because it has just destroyed the road, it destroyed the grass, the lawn, and everything. He'd worked himself into a tizzy and had a headache, and so my mom said, "You need to calm your dad down." So I thought, and this last couple weeks, God's been really dealing with us on holiness. And I thought, how does holiness handle this? And because he's my dad, and I respect my dad, I love my dad so much. And he is a very godly man. And I said, I went over to my dad's house, and I said, "Dad, God is in this." I said, "God brought a semi-truck into your front yard." And I said, "And so that you could minister to the people in this truck." And my mom said that he was going to hold that truck hostage there until they came and paid for it. And I said, Dad, God brought this truck to you. God knows what's going on. I said, "Minister to these people." And my mom said that after God talked to my dad, that Dad invited him in for a cup of coffee and a cup of hot chocolate and let them leave with the help of a tow truck. And, yeah, they wiped out our mailbox. When they turned in the driveway, they knocked down all the snow poles, and then it's just like speed bumps all the way down our road. But God used that whole thing in such a mighty way, and it's just awesome how he works. And I give him all the praise and all the glory. And and I told my dad, I said, "Dad, in 1 month, you won't even know anything happened out here. Everything will be fixed. But for the rest of the lives of those two drivers, they will know how you showed them Jesus Christ."
I have a couple things. Surgery went well. They actually didn't find any infection, which was huge praise. Now I'm going through oxygen therapy, and that's been a challenge, but just pray that this does it so I can get my life back. And then another, the wreck that happened on Tuesday morning with a teenager, I knew him. His mom is one of my best friends. So that was, it was a very hard week because I just know that they've had a lot of bad luck coming, but they are believers and the whole family. But went to the funeral yesterday, and while it was sad, I learned that Andrew had accepted Jesus as personal Savior when he was 4. So that gave me a lot of peace to know that he had made that decision. And it also reflected on because he has a sister that's older than him, and it reflected on how much I don't keep in touch with my younger brother. And I got all sappy and told my brother, you know, I love you, and, you know, and so it's just, I found the importance of family and sticking together, because it was, you never know when that last moment's going to be. And it's been a really hard week, but I know that they're going to recover from it. It's just going to take a while.
Any other praises?
I have to stand up again because I'm so short. Okay.
I have two praises, actually. One is Friday, Vic and I were both sick with the flu, stomach flu. Oh, my goodness, did that tear us up. And the bad thing about it was that we were both sick. So there's, like, nobody to take care of, nobody. So all day Friday, you don't laugh. It's coming. So all day Friday, all we did was sit in his chair, and I laid on the couch and moaned and groaned. And didn't eat. I'm kind of hoping I lost maybe 3 pounds in that one day. And the second thing I want to say is, God, of course, God bless us, because by Saturday we were feeling much better. I was feeling good enough to get up and clean my house because it was so bad. Anyway, the second blessing is we have been blessed to be able to move. So February the 24th, we will be moving to another apartment, which is across the street from where we live now. It's the same apartment complex. It's the same apartment, but this one has a nice big patio in the front, and there's light that comes in the window, so it's not so dark. And I am so looking forward to it, because I just kept praying to the Lord, get me out of the cell block 15. That's what I called her. That's what I called her apartment. Cell block 15. So anyway, February the 24th, we could use all the help we can get in moving. Thank you very much, Adrian.
Coming back.
It's just good to be back. It seems like it's been like 6 weeks since we've been here. But I've been preaching out at Mill Creek Baptist Church the first two Sundays, but December wound up being the first and the third, and then the third was canceled, so I wound up being the first and the last, and then last week was canceled here. So it's like, man, it's been forever, but it's always good to come home. And then I want to thank Tim and Dallas. Yesterday, a good friend of mine, Ron Nolan, who's come here, he's moved here behind the apartments behind Sam's. And I called Tim and I said, can you and Wayne, or you and some and another person, meet me here to help unload his truck, because he moved yesterday. So Tim and Dallas showed up, and of course Ron's on the second floor, so I learned real quick, like, there's 17 steps going up to his floor because we were moving. But Ron kept asking me over and over again, who are these guys? Are these guys bodybuilders? It's unbelievable how they're moving things. We unloaded that truck in an hour, and Ron just couldn't believe it. But, you know, that blessed him so much. I just appreciate, you know, guys here that, you know, they didn't know him, but they knew that he needed help, and they answered the call. So I just want to thank them for that.
Amen.
Friday morning, I got up and I was getting around and I was like, oh yeah, I've got to get a gift for a friend of mine, a client of mine that I've done her hair since she was little. She's graduating from college and I wanted to get her a graduation gift. So I was thinking, okay, what should I get? And as soon as I said that in my head, I heard in my head, she needs a big girl Bible. Well, I wouldn't have said that in my head. I mean, that's not really my wordage. Apparently, it's the Holy Spirit's wordage that he knew I would take and use, because I would, with her, I don't know that I would have said that. I don't really know where she stands with the Lord. We've talked a little bit, but I don't really think she knows him as Savior. And I was really uncomfortable doing that. I'm not a person who usually buys a Bible for someone that's just a client of mine. But I did exactly what I felt like he told me to do. I went to Lifeway and I found her a big girl Bible, a ladies' Bible that was one I thought she could understand and all this. And I took it and gave it to her yesterday. And I said, before you open this, I want you to know that the Holy Spirit said you needed a big girl Bible. And her face got very white, and she said, the only Bible I have is a little picture Bible from when I was little.
Amen.
So I said, well, now I know why he said you needed a big girl Bible.
Amen. Amen.
Patty had her baby.
Amen.
Oh, boy. Anyway. Okay. I watched this movie. It's called War Room, and I only watched it because everybody said it was great. And to be honest, I've really not liked most Christian movies because the acting is so bad. There's always, you know, but this one was different, and maybe I was different, but it was really good, but it was beyond good because this is something I've been thinking about doing. Where I used to live, I kind of cleared out a little. I went to pray in a little in my closet, but it's full of stuff, so I was always getting distracted. But where I live now, there's a closet right outside my bedroom, and I cleared it out because I know the Lord was trying to get me to do this, and I've got all prayers everywhere, all over the place, and that makes it, that's like strategy, is what they were talking about. So that helps me to pray about each individual. The government's on there, all the different ones. I didn't do that real well the other day, but my children, of course, are very important to me, like they're all everybody. But I just want to thank the Lord because He'd confirmed, I mean, it was like a confirmation because it wasn't something I got all, oh yeah, I'll do this because this thing says that it's a great thing to do. It's something that the Lord had been talking to me about for a long time. So, thank you.
Any other praises? I probably have a few. My grandma passed away two Thursdays ago. So back up a little bit. She was diagnosed about a month ago with stage 4 lung cancer. They found some spots in her kidney. And when they had drained fluid once, and by the time they'd done the PET scan, it had moved to her brain. And so I went over and talked to her while she was at the house one day, and we just had a good conversation. And probably like Vonda was dealing with some holiness issues, God had been telling me that what we're talking about in church and what we're talking about in discipleship, we need to be doing. And so my grandma was raised Catholic, lived Catholic, and if you're familiar with the Catholic Church, that is very different, to say the least, from what we do. And so went back, and she'd been put in the hospital, and they were just kind of waiting. And so my cousin who lives in Greece made the emergency trip back, and I was dealing with some, I don't know, bitterness or harshness towards that, but when I'd went and seen my grandma in the hospital, I knew that, yep, he needed to come back. And so two Sundays before she passed, we were all there and she was talking. All the grandsons were there. We were able to spend time with her and to more or less say our goodbyes. And so Randy and my mom were kind of hanging out with her when they were getting ready to give her a sponge bath and move her and change her sheets and everything. Well, the good husband I am, I sent Randy a text message. Hey, this is an opportunity to be bold. I'm praying for you. Good luck.
She didn't get the text message till later.
Yeah, she didn't get the text message. That's
because it was Jeremy's job.
The problem. So we went back. We got some pictures developed. We went back and took them to her. And so we're all kind of standing there, and I'm at the foot of the bed, and I'm talking to her, and she's talking to me, and so I kind of like given hints that, hey, you know, maybe you should go get the great-grandkids and just bring them in, thinking I'd have, you know, like a minute or two by myself with her to talk to her. And nobody left. So I thought, okay. So I'm telling my two younger cousins, hey, you know, if you guys just want to leave, you can. That's fine. You're good. And they didn't leave. So I inched my way up to the head of the bed, and I said, I'm kind of waiting for people to leave. I told my other cousin, hey, go get my girls, thinking I'd have a little bit of time. And it just, nobody would leave until I said, hey, can I have a few minutes with my grandma? And I don't remember the door closing, and so Randy was in there with me, and I was very point blank with my grandma. I'm not a crier. I asked her, I said, Grandma, have you asked Jesus into your heart? And her response was, I don't know. And I said, okay, we can take care of that. I said, do you want to know for sure? And her response was, well, do you think I'm going to die tonight? And I said, no, but would you like to know? And she said, okay. And I said, it's pretty simple. You just need to pray. And she said, she kind of said, okay. And then I think she mumbled some stuff. She was kind of a little bit in and out of there. And I had to look at Randy because I didn't know what she was saying, and Randy didn't know what she was saying. And so I said, Grandma, it's pretty easy. If you just want to repeat after me, that'd be great. And she goes, well, I don't know about repeating, but I'll pray with you. You pray. I said, okay. I prayed that God would give her peace, that God would be with her, that God would heal her, and that we can have the hope and faith that when we cry out to Jesus, he comes to our, he comes and lives in our hearts when we ask him to. And her response to that was, amen, very loud and very clear. The difficult part for me is I struggle with, I'm looking for, probably as most of us would, the normal response. The normal, okay, I'm going to come to Jesus and I'm going to repeat the quote-unquote sinner's prayer and I'm going to pray it with you and life will be good after that. I didn't get the normal response, but I've kind of confirmed it with some other people, some other pastors. Another pastor friend of my mom and dad's prayed with her and she did the exact same thing. She wouldn't repeat everything, but she would squeeze and say amen very loud and clear. So, I do want to thank you guys. I know some of you came to Topeka for the funeral, or to Junction City for the funeral. That blew the rest of my family out of the water. They were very shocked to see the love of Christ for the first time. So, thank you. Continue to pray for them as they go through everything and as they wrap everything up. But thank you so much. Lord Jesus, we just thank you for this time where we can voice praises, where we can have opportunities to voice praises with the body, that we will be encouraged. Lord, I pray that you would be with Doyle and the worship team as they lead us into your throne room, as they lead us in worship. God, I pray that your voice would be heard, that our voices would be pleasing to you. Lord, I just lift up Corey to you right now as he prepares to bring the message that you laid on his heart. I pray that you would calm his heart and his mind, Lord, that you would speak directly through him. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Our God is so faithful. Let's stand and continue to worship. And as we say every Sunday, you worship how God tells you to worship. If you can't stand, that's fine. God still hears your worship. But however it is that you commune with your God, forget who's on your left, forget who's on your right. This is an audience of one. This is for our great God who is faithful. Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not. All I have needed, thy hand has.
to God, strength for today. I see the stars.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we just come to you today, Lord, that you are holy. Lord, that you are a great God. You are a wonderful God. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that you made for us. Lord, we just turn the day over to you, Lord. Lord, we pray for Corey as he brings your message. Lord, that you would clear him of his words, Lord, that it is your words that we hear through him this morning. Lord, we pray for open hearts, Lord, that we hear your message to us. We just praise you for that. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Good. First, I just want to start off by saying thank you to the worship team for bringing us to the throne room of God this morning. That is such an awesome, awesome feeling. Like they said, my name is Corey Gillespie, and I am the youth pastor here at Maranatha Baptist Fellowship. I'm not up here usually. Usually, it's another older gentleman. But I'm here, and I'm here to talk to you about something that's really, really something that's dear to my heart and something that I'm super passionate about. If you're taking notes this morning, and if you're not, we'll get to that later. We're going to be talking about discipleship. If you know me at all, you know that discipleship is something that I love. It's probably one of the main reasons why I came to Maranatha, because if I did not have the discipleship in my life, I probably wouldn't be here right now. I'd probably be doing something else. But you also, if you know me at all, you also know one of my big passions is sports. I love sports almost as much as I love discipleship, and Jesus. You know, that's just a given, but I don't think that it needs to be said, but I say it anyways. But I love sports, and I love when we look at sports and discipleship, they go together really well. Because with discipleship, you have most of the time a coach who is someone who is teaching you how to do the sport, and that's a lot like what discipleship is. And with discipleship, there's a root word there, disciple, which means servant or teacher. Not servant or student, sorry. Not a teacher, that's a different thing. But a student or a servant. And that's a lot like in sports. You have to train. You have to learn how to do your sport before you can start it, right? Like, I can't go out and play NBA basketball, no matter how hard I try, because A, I'm 26. B, I can't jump very high yet. And B, my jump shot is off. But those guys train for a long time. They learn how to play the game of basketball. And that's a lot like discipleship, because we know that we're called to be disciples, right? We're called to be disciple makers. But we can't be disciple makers if we're first not disciples. We can't do that. That's backwards thinking, right? I mean, backward thinking for me. Hopefully it's backwards thinking for you too. But For this week and for next week, our two main passages are going to be Matthew 28, verses 16 and 20, and Acts 1 through 8. We're kind of gonna sit on those two passages for the next 2 weeks. Yes, I said 2 weeks because you get a sermon series out of me. Because when Jeremy first asked me, "Hey, do you want to preach one Sunday?" and I'm like, "Oh yeah, sure," and then, you know, God and I got to talking, and I started praying, and I fasted, and I was like, "God, what do you teach? What do you want me to say?" And he's like, "Really? Let's talk about discipleship, bro." And so I'm like, "Okay, let's talk about discipleship." He's like, no, not just 1 week. I want you to talk about 2 weeks." I'm like, "You're crazy, right? They're gonna hear me talk more in the next 2 weeks than they probably have heard me talk ever." Yeah, my parents and my grandma's here. They don't have very many stories because I didn't talk much before I left home. But So we're going to be talking about the inward life of a disciple, the inward life of a disciple of Jesus Christ. Because we have to know what a disciple is before we can even start beginning to start making disciples. So I'm going to start in Matthew 28. We're going to start in verse 16. And this is the Great Commission. This is one of Jesus' last commands to his disciples before he leaves earth. And he said, and Gospel of Matthew says, the 11 disciples traveled to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had directed them. When they saw him, they worshipped, but some doubted. Then Jesus came near and said to them, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Mark verse 19. Important. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe everything I have commanded you, and remember, I am with you always to the end of the age. So this is the Great Commission. This is one of Jesus' last commands to his disciples. He tells us to go and make disciples. And then we jump to Acts 1:8. I know we're doing Bible drills, practicing Bible drills for later. Remember, Acts 1:8. I'll give you a couple seconds to get there. Sorry, I posted note mine so that I know where I'm going, because I'm really bad at Bible drills, so I have to cheat. Acts 1:8, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So again, that is another command that Jesus has for his disciples. Now, I want to, we kind of think of these as Jesus commands. I want to change our thinking for a second. I want to look not as a Jesus, but as a disciple. So when we see that this is kind of like the middle point, the go point, this is when Jesus sends out his disciples. This is like the climax of the English storyline thing that I didn't do well in English, so that's why I didn't major in it. But this is the climax. This is the go point. This is the sending out point of the disciples. And we see that there is an obvious after. They go out and they make disciples. There are thousands of accounts of them going out to China, to Asia, to Africa, to where, all these different places. But I want to, that's going to be next week's talk, so I'm going to table that half of the talk. We're going to talk about the before, the part of the before, when they got to spend time with Jesus, learning about his, learning teachings, and learning what it is to be a disciple. So, and I have a very simple kind of abstract idea of what it kind of, this is what I learned when I was getting discipled. But first there's a story. So before you guys knew me, except for these three right here, I was not the way that I looked right now. I was very, very heavy set. I think there's a picture, because I know a lot of you wanted to see a picture. That is me, I think my sophomore or junior year of college. That is a whopping 260 pounds on my... Tim, you've already seen that picture. But 2 or 3 years ago, I made the decision. You can take that off. I don't think they want to see that for the entire sermon. Thank you. But 2 or 3 years ago, I made the decision, hey, I want to live healthier. I want to be healthy. And so when I was studying in college, I had a nutrition class and an exercise class. And we learned this principle, which makes no sense to me, but it's called FAT, F-A-T. And so my principle for the next 2 or 3 years was, to take away the fat, you got to be fat. To take away the fat, you got to be fat. Lowercase fat is the first one, and the acronym FAT is food, accountability, and time of activity. Okay? Because when you're losing weight, you want to eat the right things, right? Because your body is a machine, so you have to fuel it the right way. And you have to have accountability. Because if you don't have accountability when you're trying to lose weight, you're going to fail 95% of the time. In a time of activity, you have to be active. You have to be learning how to be active, how to do those things. You have to be active. And you have to spend time doing that. And so when I started getting discipled by the guy who's discipling now, his name's Kyle, he brought up this idea of we as disciples need to be fat. So yes, I'm saying it's okay to be fat as a disciple. It's okay to be fat. So the first F, the F of the word fat when it comes to being a disciple, is we got to be faithful. Got to be faithful. The A is the same one as the other one. It's accountable. Got to be accountable. And the last one is teachable. Teachable is probably one of the ones that I have the most struggle with. And probably, teachable. Yeah, that's probably my biggest struggle. But we're going to start out with the F. We're going to start out with faithful. So when you hear the word faithful, this is a group discussion. What do you hear? Faithful. What do you hear? Steadfast. Immovable. Show up. Reliability. Yeah. All good answers. Good job, class. So when we're talking about faithfulness, we have to be faithful to what God commands us to do. In John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32, it says, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Let me read that again. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. We have to be faithful. We have to spend time. We have to be faithful to read this book that I have like 7 Bibles at my apartment. I have a whole shelf of Bibles. And I know the average American household has like 3, but I think the average American reads their Bible twice a year. That's a gut shot. Huge gut shot. We have to be faithful to read this daily. Because if we don't read this, we won't know what God's saying to us. We won't know what God wants from us to be disciples. Because how can we not read this and not know what it says and then go out and try and make disciples? Because if we don't know what it says, I doubt they're going to know what it says either. So we have to show them the truth of what this says, because we have the truth. It says it right there in John chapter 8. "And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." Boom, right there. Jesus juked. Boom. One day you'll understand. So just some quick ways that you can be faithful as a disciple is obviously read your Bible. But it goes much further than that. We have to be faithful. I don't have this issue, but we have to be faithful in our marriages. One day I will have to do that, but right now I don't have to. But we have to be faithful in our marriages. We have to be faithful in our families. We have to be faithful at our jobs. Because imagine the amount of light that you are shining at your job is ridiculous. It's ridiculous. So those are some ways that we can be faithful. Because if we're faithful in reading our Bibles, we'll be faithful in everything else. It overflows. So the next one is accountability. This is I'm gonna speak as a guy real fast. As a man, being accountable is hard. Because A, we have to talk to one another. B, we have to share our feelings. And C, we have to be truthful. I know, right? It's hard. But imagine if we're accountable, if we're sharing with one another the things that God is teaching us through our reading of their Bible, or maybe things that we're struggling with. Imagine the amount of community and fellowship that we can have. Because it says in the Bible, a cord of one is weak, a cord of two is strong, but a cord of three is unbreakable. So that's the idea that we're taking, is if we're accountable with our brothers, then we can move mountains, literally. The best way that I mean, I'm going to say it, accountability partner or accountability groups. I have a accountability group that I meet with every, well, depending on my new job, Tuesday mornings at 6 a.m. That's early for most of you. That's sleeping in for me. 6 a.m., we've met for 5 straight years, almost every Tuesday. We miss about like 5 or 6 Tuesdays a year. So that's right around 50 weeks a year. We meet everywhere, and we talk about our feelings, again, which is hard. We talk about when we were all in school, we talked about things we were struggling with in school, our worries. We were talking about, those guys are married, so we got to talk a lot about how they were going to propose to their wives, and I really kind of cared a little bit, but not all that much. So, but I was a good brother, and I said, oh, congratulations. But we share in our struggles. We share in our sin, because that is the main reason we got to talking, is because we shared a common struggle, a common sin, and so we built that accountability group around that sin. And now we're not perfect. We have trouble with that sin still, but we are much better because we have been brought closer to God through our accountability. So, what's F?
Faithful.
If your name's Jeremy, you can't talk anymore. What's A? Accountable. Awesome. Now the last one. Teachable. Okay, I'm gonna drop some challenges in teachable. Are you guys ready for some challenges? I like some challenges. My first one, the first one, I think when we talk about teachable, we have to be willing to be listening to what God has to say to us, and be available to the things that He has. The first one is, we all got one of these, right? When I was in high school, I had a custodial job at our church. And every Monday morning, I had to go and clean the sanctuary because apparently people are dirty on Sunday mornings. So, but my main job was to fill, because we had pews. And so you know how in pews there's the racks with the Bibles and the hymnals and stuff? People would stuff the bulletins in there. It was really annoying because especially if they took the Bible out, put theirs, and then crunched it in there, be like crunched up. But that was really, I would take out an entire garbage bag of bulletins. Garbage bag. And the reason why I bring this up, because you know what's in here, right? There's dates, there's things of importance, there's Bible study times and numbers and addresses and things you can be praying about, right? You know, but if you don't take this home, how are you going to remember that? I don't remember anything most of the time if I don't have this. That's, I mean, Jeremy can attest, I text him when I forget things, because I forget things often if I don't write them down. But I'm going to challenge you to take this home and look at it during the week. Pray about the things that are happening. Like, if you don't go to the Tuesday Bible studies, pray for those Bible studies. If there's a prayer corner, literally, there's a prayer corner right here. That's my, because you want to know what's going on in the church, because you want to be involved. And how are you going to be involved if you don't know what's happening? Now the next one. This one is my favorite, because it always gut checks me and a lot of people. This is my notebook. When we want to be teachable, we want to be learning, right? You want to learn. But when you don't write things down, you remember 48.5% of what you hear. Hey, I didn't do the study. I just found the stats. And I'm a stats guy, if you know me. I love stats. 48.5%, because your brain can't remember everything that is said because you don't process it that fast. But when you write it down, you remember 85% of it. Because A, you write it down, and you can look at it. So if you're writing things down, you're going to remember it, and you can take it back with you and look at it during the week. and then you got something to study, you know, something to pray about. I mean, boom, right there. Come on now. But I have a friend. His name is Max Barnett. He is pretty much like the godfather of discipleship. It's like Dawson Trotman, who is the founder of Navigators, like the top discipleship group in the whole entire world. Then there's Max Barnett. Dawson Trotman discipled Max Barnett. Max Barnett is still alive. He's like 90-something, I think. And he goes out to Oklahoma, to Kansas, to Colorado, all these different states, and he will sit in the back. And this guy he said he's read his Bible almost 100 times, probably even more than that. Frontwards, backwards, side to side, probably in a different language or two. But he will go back and sit in the back and take notes. He doesn't care who's speaking, if it's I'm speaking, if it's Jeremy speaking, if it's David Platt speaking, if it's Francis Chan, or even if it's Wayne preaching, he will still take notes. His reason is being because you don't know what God has to say to you. You don't know what God has to say to you. God doesn't speak, people don't speak to you, God speaks through people to you. And how are you going to remember that if you don't take notes? And it helps you pay attention. I don't pay attention very well. So all in all, we're talking about what it's like, the inward life of a disciple. These are some things that I'm not saying that I do these perfectly, because I don't. I struggle with faith, being faithful reading my Bible. Honest. I struggle with being accountable, because I don't like talking. I am really hard at being teachable. Really hard at being teachable. So these are just some things that we need to work on, that I need to work on, and I think everybody needs to work on. Let's just be honest. I'll throw it out there. And if we want to be these disciple makers, that we know we're supposed to be, these are the things we need to work on. So, the musicians, as they come up, I just want you to close your eyes, bow your heads, and I just want you to start talking with God. Start listening to what God has to say to you today. Maybe it's, hey, it's time to be fat. Or, hey, you're fat enough. Let's go make disciples. Maybe it's one of those two. Or maybe it's something completely different. Just spend some time just listening to what God has to say to you. And maybe you've come here today not knowing what a relationship with Jesus looks like. And you've heard him talking to you today. And you're like, hey, I want to be this disciple. I want to be a disciple. I want to make disciples. But I would love to talk to you today. So just sit there and allow God to speak.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. I want to see. I want to see. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you, I want.
I just want to thank you for being here today. If this is your first time being here, don't let the preaching not bring you back. Let God bring you back. So, again, just thank you. I'm going to pray, and then you are going to be dismissed. Lord, just thank you for who you are. Thank you for loving us, even though we don't deserve it, Lord. Lord, I pray that as we leave today, we would go out and be your disciples. We would go and make disciples. We would be disciples to a broken world, Lord. Lord, just thank you again for today, for your just loving us so much, Lord. Again, we can't say thank you enough, Lord. It's in your Son's name we pray.